بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله أما بعد We begin with the name of Allah, the creator of the heavens and the earth, the Lord and God of all mankind. And may the peace and blessings of Allah and salutations be upon his final messenger, Muhammad. So to proceed today, we're going to start the first actual class, even though this is the second class. Last time we gave a little introduction. For those of you who were here, I think I saw some of the faces here that were here, some new faces, right? And we're going to actually start the class from today. So now I don't want you to think of it as a class like a traditional class, right? I want you to be a little bit more interactive, feel a little bit more comfortable to ask questions because I think most of you here are non-Muslim. And this is probably the first time you're hearing about Islam and it might be new concepts to you and a lot of things might be very alien to what you may have already been taught or know about Islam or other than Islam. Now, for all intents and purposes, we're going to call the class Islam 101. Right? Why? Because we're going to 101 meaning it's just basic. We're going to talk about the very basics of what is Islam. And that is to introduce you all to the basic concepts of Islam, the foundations of Islam. And what I want to do is in each session, what we want to do is just take one concept or definition of something in Islam, right? Just very simple, right? And try to build from there. Many of you, maybe you might be inclined towards Islam, maybe not. Maybe this is just for your general knowledge. As I said, we live in a society that is supposed to be tolerant of one another. And we need to know what is Islam. And there's a lot of misconceptions about Islam. A lot. I mean, I've heard all sorts of fallacies growing up in Trinidad and Tobago. I was raised in Trinidad and I moved to Tobago 20 something, maybe 25 years ago. And I went to school, even though I was born a Muslim, I was never really a practicing Muslim. But when I started practicing Islam and I came to Tobago and I started hearing some of the things, you know, unfortunately, a lot of the things were very, very misconstrued, you know, because unfortunately, here in Trinidad and Tobago, we have a history where there's a racial divide in Trinidad and Tobago, right? More so in Trinidad, right? You have the Indians and the Africans, right? Everybody's aware of this. It's not a secret. And everybody here is adults anyway. And in the early days, in the 1800s, when the British brought the indentured laborers to Trinidad, they brought the Indians from what was then India in parts of what would now be considered Pakistan, perhaps, or parts of Muslim India, and the Muslims from India came there. Now, Islam is not a religion that is from India, but there are a lot of Muslims there. There are a lot of Muslims in, as a matter of fact, when they came here and they met the slaves, even though the indentured laborers came here in the 1850s, somewhere around there, the British brought them here to replace it would be after 1864 because they abolished slavery, I think, in 1864. And so they were no longer slaves to work in the slave plantations, right, for the British, the colonial powers. So they brought the Indians over to work in the plantations and they were supposed to be paid, which unfortunately a lot of them weren't paid and they were only given reparations very recently. So this is just, I guess, giving you a brief history because we live in Trinidad and Tobago, right? So when the indentured laborers came over, they were Indians from India. A lot of them were Muslims. Some of them were Hindu. And because of the racial divide that existed between the Africans and the Indians stuck together because of race and the Africans stuck together. Now, again, when the Indians came here, they met a lot of the Africans that were actually Muslim. How many of you knew that? Many of the African slaves that came here were originally Muslim because they came from parts of West Africa, Benin, Mali, parts of West Africa that were Muslim for centuries. So even though the colonial powers tried to state that a lot of the African slaves were uneducated and they had this kind of indigenous religion that was not very educated, that is false. A lot of them were educated scholars in Islam. Now, many of them memorized the Quran, our holy book. Many of them were actual people of knowledge on a basic level anyway when it comes to Islam and educated. So the Indians met some Africans here that were slaves, that were former slaves, that were Muslims. Now the Indians and the Africans stuck together. So the point of the story here is when the Indians stuck together, even though regardless of religion, you had the Hindus and the Muslims in Indian race sticking together, a lot of their practices started to merge because of that. So you find like a lot of things that the Muslims would do now was Hindu practices. A lot of things the Hindus would do, they would celebrate Eid with the Muslims, the Muslims would celebrate Diwali with the Hindus, and they stuck together. And therefore, it had this kind of thing where people started thinking, well, the Muslims were Hindus and the Hindus were kind of Muslim, and they didn't really make that separation. And in fact, it became to the point where they started calling the African slave Madinga. And many of you maybe heard that word. They would call them Madinga Muslims. Right, and it was a derogatory term that they used for the Africans, the Indians used for the Africans, because the Madinga tribe was actually a tribe from Nigeria that were a Muslim tribe. So the Muslims of the Indian origin looked at the Muslims from the Nigerian origin as inferior, and they started looking down at one another because of that racism. But that racism was created by the colonial powers, the white man, for the lack of a better way of putting it, right? The colonial powers decided that they needed to, that's how they went around the world, divide and conquer. They would cause people to go against one another. And they didn't want people to know about Islam. That's the reality. Because they know that Islam was a liberating force. Islam was not like Christianity that they brought, where they subdued people with that Christianity and made them into slaves to them and to their empire. Islam was actually making people come out of that slavery into the slavery of the Creator. And that into the slavery of Allah, of the one true God. And that made them liberated from all the other means that they used to use them for profiteering, bottom line. To use people as profiteer, because again, they needed slave labor and or cheap labor to continue the sugar plantations, the cocoa plantations, the coconut plantations, and so on and so forth. So, I don't know how many of you are interested in history. I'm a bit of a history buff. I love history. World history, Caribbean history. You like history? I love history. And I think if we study history, history is a thing. When we see where we come from, we know where we're headed. That's very important. You know, and if we research independent history and we stay away from some of the history that they brainwashed us with, you will see that, you know, again, some of the things that they taught us were very, very incorrect. And for certain agendas too, they had agendas the way they taught us things, right? So we're going to call it Islam 101. So we're going to talk about some basic things, just one concept every class, and hopefully we could grasp that, right? So the first thing we want to talk about is, and when we begin this journey, is the affair of that puts all of humanity, all of the human race, on one equal footing, right? On one equal footing. And that is that, how did Allah create us? Right, we all have a form of creation story. Every civilization, every culture, every ideology. In Islam, it's no different. We were told by our God, our Creator, Al-Khaliq, it's called in Arabic. He's the creator of everything. How he created us. And he created us all equal. What I mean by he created us all equal is that he created us on something that we call the original disposition. Or in Arabic, The fitra, and I'm going to show you what this word is here. It's a very, very important word. It's called fitra, and fitra, right? Many of you could see that, right? It's not, right? Fitra is the natural disposition that Allah, God Almighty, created us upon. What does that mean? It means that God Almighty created us with an innate inclination towards knowing Him as the one true God and knowing that He alone deserves to be worshipped, and we want to be grateful to Him for that. That's that what we call the innate natural disposition, right? And that is very important, because that original disposition that we were created upon, if it is left intact, if it is left in place as a child when we were born, it would cause us to nurture ourselves. We would grow upon what we call Islam, meaning that we will want to submit to that one true God. In fact, our Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, he mentioned that all of the human babies, all of the humans are born upon the fitrah. And it is their parents who make them into a Jew or a Christian or a Magian or a Zoroastrian or a pagan then, basically. What does he mean? He means that all the other constructs that are man-made constructs in religion are given to us by external influences, nurture. But by nature, we are born believing in one true God and that he alone deserves to be worshipped. But other external influences make us disposed towards or lean towards falseness and different shades of falsehood. So, you know, we are all born. And now, why is this concept so important? Before I go on, right? This is starkly different to Christianity. Again, how many of you all are born Christian here or are Christian? How many of you go to church regularly? And do you actually have a familiarity with the Bible? Do you read the Bible? Have you read the Bible? Do you do any kind of Bible class or so on? Yeah? Yeah? In Christianity, without exception, every denomination of Christianity, whether it be Catholicism, the Roman Christianity that began, the Roman Christianity that began in the early part of Christian history, or any of the Protestant forms of Christianity, whether it be Lutheranism or Pentecostal, Presbyterian, Seventh-day Adventist, Anglican, all of those broke away from Catholicism, all have a concept known as original sin. How many of you have heard of that? Original sin. Anybody else heard of this concept? Yeah? What is original sin? For those of you who say you go to Bible school or you go to church regularly, tell me. Okay, excellent. So he says, when God told Adam and Eve not to eat the apple or the forbidden fruit from the garden, and they ate it. So we're almost there. We're halfway there. That is actually the original sin. Correct. You're actually correct. But we're halfway there because the original sin, the concept of original sin goes further than that. It transcends all the way to us. How does it transcend to us? According to Christianity now, not Islam. I'm just showing you what is the difference between Islam and Christianity with this belief. Yes, sir. We are born in sin. Excellent. According to Christianity, we are born in sin. And it means that every human being is born with the burden of the sin that Adam and Eve did. And the only way to free themselves from that is to accept that Jesus died for your sins and that you will gain atonement through the blood of Jesus Christ. This is the belief of Christianity. We as Muslims do not have that belief. In fact, we consider it a grave injustice to say that somebody else, especially a great prophet and messenger like Jesus, peace be upon him, has to bear the burden of sin for all of mankind. Furthermore, it is so illogical that what about the people who were born before Jesus' time? Are they to bear the sin without Jesus Christ's coming? And there's a lot of argument for this concept. The reality is, this concept of original sin is not the correct concept. We were born pure. We do not need to atone our sins. Allah tells us in the Quran, the word of God, the inerrant word of God from Allah himself. He says, وَلَا تَعْزِرُ وَازِرَةً وِزْرَ أُخْرَى. No soul will bear the burden of another. You see, the concept of original sin and having to get atonement by accepting it, it's a sort of concept that allows human beings to be complacent of their sin. So you go around sinning, and once you say, and I'm sure you would have heard this concept already, once you accept that Jesus Christ died for your sins, then it doesn't matter what you do. Because at the end of the day, he died for your sins before you even committed them. So at the end of the day, no matter what you do, you're an adulterer, you're a fornicator, you're a murderer, you're a thief, Jesus died for your sins, and that is the end of that. so he could get away with it. There's nothing like that in Islam. In Islam, we are taught that in atom's weight, everything that you do, you will be held accountable for it. Okay, so we're going to round up here now, right? Just give me 1 minute. Let me finish up. So, this concept of original sin is not found in Islam, and it is considered a grave injustice. Whereas with fitrah, the natural disposition that we were created upon, pure and every... I mean, how are you going to look at a little baby, an infant, and say this is a creature? This for us is a grave injustice. A baby is born pure, and it is their parents or their external influences that make them fall into these shades of misguidance, different levels of misguidance. And only the very extreme liars of mankind will not accept that there is a God and that God deserves to be worshipped. They're called atheists. Everybody know what an atheist is? Somebody who doesn't believe in God. Right? The reality is everybody believes in God. Whether you accept it or not, you know that you are predisposed to believe that there is a God. The empirical evidence is what you see, what you hear tells you that there is a God. Allah tells us in the Quran, there's an argument for that. He says, were you created by yourselves? Or were you created from nothing? The answer is no. You know and I know you can't create yourself. And you know and I know that you weren't created from nothing. So we know that there is a creator. We know that there's a God. So anybody who says otherwise means that they are just bringing a veil over themselves and they are one of the extreme liars of mankind. Even, and I'll just close with this quote. There's an individual by the name of Richard Dawkins. He's one of the most famous atheists in the world. He's a scientist, but he's an atheist. You'll find a lot of these science folks are extreme disbelievers in God. They're atheists. They believe in science, Scientology, and Big Bang Theory, and all this stuff, right? So they try to equate creation with other than the creator. And they failed. They failed miserably, regardless of what. Even their so-called scientific experiments can't be proved empirically. They just try to bamboozle you and fool people with formulas and certain theories, and that's all they are, theories. The theory of evolution, the theory of the Big Bang. It's really theory, and they can't prove it. But the world has become subjugated to these theories, thinking that, oh, well, that's science. So at the end of the day, science had to be true. And they say, oh, well, all the people who believe in, you know, God, all they just believe blindly. But you believe blindly too. You believe in blindly in a man in the 20th century who did an experiment that he can't even prove, whereas we believe in the prophets and messengers who came before. Who's better? So this guy, Richard Dawkins, there was a quotation. I'll just give you the quotation that he said. He had a fixed debate one time at the University of Alabama. He said, and he admitted, this is an atheist now. Listen to what he says. He says, I think that when you consider the beauty of the world and you wonder how it came to be what it is, you are naturally overwhelmed with a feeling of awe, a feeling of admiration, and you almost feel a desire to worship something. I feel this. We, all of us, share a kind of religious reverence for the beauties of the universe, for the complexity of life, for the sheer magnitude of the cosmos, the sheer magnitude of the geological time. And it's tempting to translate that feeling of awe and worship and geological time. It's tempting to translate that into worship, into the desire to worship some particular thing. A person, an agent, or an agent. You want to attribute it to a maker or a creator. Allahu Akbar. So you see, even he is trying to say that all the wonderful things you see in the phenomenon, the movement of the stars and the sun, and the way the sun rises from the east and sets in the west, and there's no change in that, and the way that the universe works, and the way that all the things that they observe, you can't help but feel awe and reverence. You can't help but incline towards that, wanting to worship a God or believe in a God. You understand? And Allah tells us in the Quran, He says, Fitratullaha allati فَتَرَ النَّاسِ عَلَيْهَا لَا تَبْدِيلَ بِخَلْقِ اللَّهِ, which translates that the fitrah that Allah has created you upon, that Allah has molded mankind upon, you will not find any change in it. لَا تَبْدِيلَ بِخَلْقِ اللَّهِ, you will not find any change. That is a proof of that. Look at this guy. this atheist guy, Richard Dawkins, one of the top atheists in the world, or scientists, even him has to admit that there is a creator, and that is why, because we were born upon that fitra, that natural disposition, each and every one of us believing that there's one God, pure and sinless, knowing that there's one true God. So we'll talk a little bit about that more again in the next class, inshallah, God willing. And quickly, if anybody has any quick questions, I know we are already over time. Anybody, anything, any kind of question? Good day, good day. Yeah, of course, we finished now anyway, but you could come in. Any questions at all, any about what we spoke about? No? Okay, so again, we'll continue next week, inshallah, God willing. And I hope that maybe, you know, I will get to see you guys next week. Make sure and try to come out. And if you can, invite anybody else that you have that might, they don't necessarily need to be interested. If they have a free period now, let them come and just sit with us, listen. You know, maybe they might learn something. Again, you may or may not be inclined towards being Muslim, and that's neither here or there. We want guidance for mankind, but at the end of the day, we just want to disseminate knowledge. We want people to know what we are and who we are and what we stand for, and alleviate some of those misconceptions. Right? Subhanak. Thank you very much. Next week, wa subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.